God is not in many homes, not being followed, not being obeyed. It's such an honor and privilege to preach to you guys the word of God this morning. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to preach. Super thankful for the Hardings being here with us. Super exciting to be training with them. It's great to have our dear sister Popcorn back with us. Now I get to hear her voice in the fellowship. It's awesome. Let's go to God in prayer. God, thank you so much for all that you do for us. God, we are worthless servants trying to just do right in such a wicked world. God, I pray that this morning we can all be cut by the heart, by the scriptures this morning, that we see that we are here to do an incredible task, to reach every soul, to make disciples of all nations, baptizing them, and spreading the gospel throughout the whole world. God, we thank you so much for life. God, we know that we all deserve to wake up and have some kind of disease. There's so many people who didn't wake up this morning. And so we're so grateful for life itself. God, thank you so much for our salvation. That despite all the wicked sins we've been a part of, you allowed us to come into your wonderful light. God, I pray that you speak through me, God. Push me aside. And I pray that you take this lesson and really cut your people today. God, we love you. God, we dedicate the sermon and the service to you. So in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Turn your Bibles to Acts 17.
Come on, bro.
You know, today we're here as a family.
Come on,
it's incredible that the Lovochev's House Church, the Incredibles, are out somewhere in Culver City having a service.
Come on, bro.
But we're here with the Wild House Church and the House of Heroes House Church.
Come on.
And so it's super exciting. But not just that, not just here in Southland, all throughout LA there are services going on worshiping our Father in Heaven.
Amen.
That's not just it. There are people in different parts of the United States worshiping God.
Come on, bro.
There are even people in third world countries today worshiping the Lord.
Yeah.
You know, we saw great news from Sydney, Australia, which we were able to go and help plant. They had their first service over 100 in attendance today.
Wow.
How incredible that is.
Woo.
With the disciples, only 12 disciples going on the mission team, now 40 disciples, they had over 100 in attendance. That's incredible.
Woo.
See, we serve a mighty God this morning.
Yeah.
And this morning, I want to convince you that God has called you to go and work.
Come on, man.
That God has called you to go and make disciples.
Come on, man.
That I don't care what you think about yourself this morning, God looks at you and he's excited when he looks at you.
Come on, bro.
And with that, we should have been compelled in our hearts to do something incredible for our God.
Yeah.
But here in Acts 17, I love this passage because all throughout the book of Acts, it's our history of our church.
Yeah.
It started in Jerusalem. But with God and the Holy Spirit, the movement started to move in a really radical way. Here, pick up in verse 6. See, there's a lot of persecution going on. But we see that in verse 6 it says, but when they did not find them, meaning the Paul and Silas, they were trying to persecute these guys. When they couldn't find them, they dragged Jason, poor Jason, and some other believers before the city officials, shouting, these men who have caused trouble all over the world have now come here. And Jason has welcomed them into his house. They are all defying Caesar's decrees, saying that there is another king, one called Jesus. When they heard this, the crowd and the city officials were thrown into turmoil. Then they made Jason and the others post bail and let them go. See, in the first century, being a disciple is not a cool thing.
Come on, bro.
See, today in our worship services and all throughout America, what people really desire at church is an awesome worship service.
Yeah.
The big bands, the great singers, dimming the lights, right? And there's a whole light show, right? But in the first century, if you were a Christian, you had a target on your back. People wanted to kill you. People didn't like that you were preaching this crazy man Jesus. And this is what's going on here. They were trying to go to this city in Ephesus and trying to persecute the disciples here. But what did they do? They find this guy, Jason, and they drag him out. See, when they couldn't find those who they wanted to kill, they just dragged whoever they could get.
Wow.
So they dragged Jason out, and what they said is these men are causing trouble all over the world. See, I love other translations of the Bible. In the Aramaic Bible, it says that these have terrorized the whole area. In the NET, it says they stir up trouble. In the BLB, the Berean Bible, it says ones having upset the world. My personal favorite, the ESV, it says these men churn the world upside down. The title of our lesson this morning, Churning Southland Upside Down. This morning I have 2 points. Point number one, campus and teens who upset the world. Point number two, singles and married stirring up trouble. Turn to Acts chapter 19. See, this morning we're not here just to be a cool little group. We are here trying to turn the world upside down. And this morning I want to convince you of that fact. See, all throughout the Bible, there are teens and campus people who were called to do incredible things. We see that in the Bible, you know, Cain and Abel were called as young people, and we know that Abel actually fulfilled the call of Jesus. Isaac was young when he was called. Rebekah was young when she was called. Esau was young when he was called. Leah, Rachel, Joseph was young when he was called. We know that Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were taken away from their land into a foreign land, right? The Babylonian Empire. Yeah. They were teens when they were taken out of their country. And we know that the Bible said that Nebuchadnezzar saw these teens as the most learned guys in every part of his empire. This is coming from the most powerful man in the world at that time. Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were the smartest guys you'll ever find in all the world at the time. But when they were called, they were teens and campus guys.
Come on, bro.
Right? They were teens. A lot of the apostles, a lot of them were young men when they were called to do something incredible for the Lord. So point number one, campus and teens who upset the world.
Come on, Mace.
See, in chapter 19, it's incredible. Paul here is in Ephesus. And what we see here, pick up in verse 8, says Paul entered the synagogue and spoke boldly there for 3 months, arguing persuasively about the kingdom of God. I love this passage because it shows you the importance of the kingdom of God. My favorite scripture about the kingdom is Acts 1, when the Bible says that Jesus appeared to the disciples in a period of 40 days and talked about what?
The kingdom
of God. So how important is the kingdom of God? Super important. Well, how important? Jesus had to come back to the dead, from the dead, to say, hey, this is what you got to do. But what do we see Paul imitating? Paul's now imitating Jesus. What is he preaching? The kingdom of God boldly there for 3 months.
Come on, man.
Verse back. 5. Verse 9. But some of them became obstinate. They refused to believe and publicly maligned the way. So Paul left them. He took the disciples with him and had discussions, or as we like to call Bible talks, daily in the lecture hall of Tyrannus. This went on for 2 years, so that all the Jews and Greeks who lived in the province of Asia heard the word of the Lord. God did extraordinary miracles through Paul. Wow, how incredible is this? We see that Paul is here in Ephesus, and he's preaching boldly about the kingdom of God. That's what we do when we go share our faith.
Yep.
It takes a lot of boldness to share your faith, doesn't it?
Yeah.
My fear is always that first person you share your faith with. Because before you hit that first person, you don't want to share your faith. Right? You're hitting that?
Come on, man.
And I don't know if you've ever done this. So I'm walking and I'm saying, I'm going to talk to this guy.
Yeah.
And then he passes. He's too far. Jesus doesn't want me running after this guy. But see, it takes a lot of boldness to preach what we preach. It takes a lot of boldness to walk up to people who don't want to hear a lick of what you have to say and say, hey, I want to talk to you about the kingdom of God. But here, when the Jews opposed Paul's teaching in the synagogue, where he preached boldly for about 3 months, he then said, hey, let me take the disciples on the campus ministry. So he takes them to the lecture hall of Tyrannus, and even now, if you actually Google it, they actually have towers still up in this area.
Wow.
So it's incredible. You kind of get some kind of a picture of what the campus ministry looks like. Mm-hmm. But he said, hey, let me take these disciples, because these guys don't want to listen to me in church. So let me just go on these worldly campuses. So they go on the world on the lecture hall of Tyrannus, and they have, every day, they have a Bible talk.
Wow.
Right?
Yeah. Come on, bro.
Tomorrow starts what? Semester starts tomorrow.
Boom. Let's go!
And at El Camino, the in campus ministry, the first 2 weeks are so crucial.
Yeah.
Right? It's going to take a lot of boldness and a lot of hard work, but the first 2 weeks, we're going to hit the ground running with the everyday Bible talk this semester.
Bro.
It's going to be awesome. But see, in this passage, the Western text adds to this passage, from the fifth hour to the tenth hour, what does that mean? That translates to from 11 a.m. to 4 p.m., Paul was on campus just sharing his faith. If this is correct, Paul took advantage of the hottest hours on campus.
Come on, yeah.
11 a.m. to 4 p.m., no different than our campus ministry even in 2016.
Yeah.
So what do we need to do? We, for campus, we need to be on campus from 11 to 4 every day.
Yeah.
Come on, it's incredible that allowed Paul to work on his trade during the off hours. So this was Paul's plan. Let me take disciples on campus every day, and from the fifth hour to the tenth hour, we're just going to go at it hard. Hey, sit down. Let me talk to you about this man, Jesus.
Come on.
I don't want to talk to you. All right, hey, you sit down. Let's talk about Jesus. Every day, right? And then what happened was on the off hours after four, we see that throughout the scriptures, Paul is working. Because as you know, us missionaries, which you guys are all missionaries,
yeah. Come on, bro. Right? Yeah.
We need money to survive.
Yeah.
And so Paul, when he wasn't sharing his faith and wasn't preaching, Paul was out there working to put himself on the full-time ministry.
Wow.
Go to Acts 20.
Come on, Mason.
That's awesome.
Acts 20, verse 34. I showed you that by this kind of hard work, we must help the weak. Remembering the words of the Lord Jesus himself said, it is more blessed to give than to receive.
Wow.
Go over to 1 Corinthians chapter 4.
Come on, bro.
Let me see. Yeah.
1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 12. We know that Paul's writing this to the disciples there in Corinth.
Yeah.
Check out this one verse, powerful. He says, verse 12 of chapter 4 of Corinthians, we work hard with our own hands.
Come on.
When we are cursed, we bless. When we are persecuted, we endure it. See, instead of resting on his off hours, on the off hours of campus, what was Paul doing? He was working with his own hands. See, the campus ministry is a ministry where, yeah, we work hard, but we also work hard off the campus. See, as disciples, everyone is putting you under a microscope.
Mm-hmm.
The minute you say you're a Christian, people are looking for the faults in you.
Come on, bro.
Because sadly, in America, Christianity has become a joke.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so there are a lot right? Because we're asking all the campus to give $100 towards special missions.
Come on.
Right? And so that is a lot more than you were thinking, but that's what we got to do. We got to imitate Paul in putting our hands to work. See, instead of resting, Paul engaged in sharing his faith and even apologetics, proving that Jesus is real.
Yeah.
That's what campus ministry is all about. See, I'm excited because I do believe that this semester, the campus will blow up to a place it's never seen before here in Southland.
Come on, bro. Come on, bro.
We've got an incredible couple, the Jones.
Come on.
And Janelle, who just had her birthday on Friday. That was awesome. We have this incredible couple heading up, spearheading the work here at El Camino. They are hard workers.
Come on.
And we're going to imitate that. Yeah. We're going to get on these campus and we're going to find these amazing gems here on campus. These guys who are just getting into a world and really don't know what they're living for.
Come on, bro.
See, they think that an education is what they're living for. But then they get at their education and go into the real world and they find out this is not their purpose.
Yeah.
So how amazing it is that we have a campus ministry to save people and give them a purpose. Amen.
Come on, yeah.
Go to John chapter 6.
Come on, bro.
Well, I can't forget about the teens.
Yeah. Woo!
In John 6, this is a story we all know, and yet I think we can miss a very important part of this story. See, campus ministry is going to be awesome. I believe we're going to blow it out. Our goal is to double in number.
Yep.
Our goal is to triple in number.
Come on.
Our goal is to quadruple in number.
Come on.
Because even when the Jones and myself leave, Aleem's going to step up and lead a Bible talk.
Come on.
Keontae's going to step up and lead a Bible talk.
Yep.
Tony Grant's going to step up and lead a Bible talk.
Come on.
We're going to get Moses. And we're going to get all these incredible young people to take a stand for God on their campus.
Yeah. Yeah.
But you can't forget about the teens.
Come on, teens.
You see, in John 6, starting in verse 5, we all know it's the feeding of the 5,000.
Yeah.
When Jesus looked up and saw a great crowd coming toward him, he said to Philip, "Where shall we buy bread for these people to eat?" I love Jesus. He wants me to be fed. I'm fired up. He asked this only to test him, for he already had in mind what he was going to do. See, when God gives you a task and you feel overwhelmed, he already has what he's going to do in mind. Verse 7, Philip answered him, "It would take more than half a year's wages to buy enough bread for each one to have a bite." See, that the disciples had attitudes. Like, what are you talking about? We're here in this deserted place, and you want me to feed these people? Do you got money? Because I ain't got no money. See, they were still in the campus ministry. They had no money. Verse 8. Another of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, spoke up. "Here is a boy with 5 small barley loaves and 2 small fish. But how far will they go among so many?" Jesus said, "Have the people sit down." There was plenty of grass in that place, and they sat down. About 5,000 men were there. Jesus took the loaves, gave thanks, and distributed to those who were seated as much as they wanted. He did the same with the fish. When they had all had enough to eat, he said to his disciples, "Gather the pieces so that that are left. Let nothing be wasted." So they gathered them and filled 12 baskets with the pieces of the 5 barley loaves left over by those who had eaten. What an incredible story.
Yeah.
And what an incredible miracle that Jesus did to multiply bread and fish. I don't know if you've ever had bread and fish together. It's a good combination. But what we see is we neglect to see the main person in this story. This teen boy who had loaves and fish.
Yeah.
I don't know about you, teens don't have money and they don't have jobs. So the little they do have, they might want to just keep that for themselves. But I believe that teens who are disciples imitate this boy. They give up all they have, but then they see 12 basketfuls of bread.
Come on, teens.
And that describes our teen ministry.
Yeah.
See, Ignite, I was privileged to be able to do the first 3 Ignites. And Ignite, if you're visiting, is a teen program where we send all of our teens, or actually a good 20 of them, 24 of them, on a 10-day 5-day retreat to really encourage and inspire them to become amazing leaders in the kingdom. This event is, in my opinion, the best thing happened in our church, where we take young people who should be in the world doing and getting into crazy sin, and we're teaching them to be powerful leaders in the kingdom.
Wow.
See, now that Dylan's baptized, we gotta send him to Ignite.
Yeah. Yeah.
Come on, Dylan.
But what do we see here? This man, this young man gave all he had. This is why we do special missions.
Yeah.
Because we, who have very little, not just the teens, I know a lot of us have very little. We went to Australia with one suitcase. One suitcase for me, one suitcase for that. When we came back to LA, we had nothing but what was in our suitcases. So everything, literally, if you come to my place, was all decorated and put together by people who just gave us free stuff.
Come on.
And I love free stuff.
Sure.
So if you have some stuff to give me, I'll take it. But why do we do special missions? If you're visiting here, you're seeing a small portion of our church worldwide. And we have a dream. Our dream is Jesus' dream. Very simple.
Mm-hmm.
To go and make disciples of all the world. Well, how are we to do that? We got to give sacrificially, like this young boy. We got to be willing to give up our nice little fish. We got to be willing to give up our nice fluffy bread so that we can see more and more people come to the faith and be a part of the kingdom of God.
Yeah.
I do want to lift up Dylan.
Ooh,
Dylan is a young man. Yesterday, it was incredible to study the Bible with this young man. But what's incredible is his heart towards missions. Here's a guy who was not even baptized at the time. Heard the call that, hey, our brothers and sisters in the third world need our help. And we're going to answer that call. And so in our church, we're calling every married to give $1,250, every single to give $500, every campus to give $350. And every team to give $100. That, if every church does that all throughout the United States, we'll be able to send a nice chunk of blessings to our brothers and sisters in the third world who need the help.
Yeah.
Well, Dylan understood this even though he wasn't baptized. This guy pulled Ron aside and said, hey, I have an idea of how to raise not $100, but $200. How is that? You have no job. How are you going to do that? I'm just going to sell my Xbox One. I don't know if you know teens.
Right.
Giving up Xbox One is a no-go. And yet this young man, just like this young boy in the scripture, was willing to give up his prized possession.
Amen.
This morning, that's all we ask of disciples. That you have to be willing, not you have to. The heart of a disciple is, man, I got to be willing to give up my prized possession to see the world evangelized in our day.
Yeah.
That's special missions. What's the challenge for our campus and our teens? How are we to upset the world? Well, just live like a disciple and you'll upset the world.
Yeah.
Man.
But we also got to win the world.
Yeah.
So my challenge for the campus and every teen here is by the end of the year, make one person into a disciple. That's possible. We're not even in September yet. It's very much possible. School is starting up.
Come on.
Campus is starting up tomorrow.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it's very possible to go and find one soul to bring into the kingdom before the end of the year.
Yeah.
Campus, are you up for the challenge?
Yeah. Yeah.
Teens, are you up for the challenge?
Yeah.
Number one, right? That's the challenge. Point number two, singles and marrieds stirring up trouble.
Let's go.
I don't care what y'all say, the Mary's ministry is the best ministry.
Yeah, yo!
You have
Mary's.
And I don't care what you say, the singles ministry is one of the best ministries going on right now.
Yeah!
Turn to Acts chapter 18. Plural, here you go. Acts chapter 18, starting in verse 24. Verse 24, Acts 18. Meanwhile, a Jew named Apollos, a native of Alexandria, came to Ephesus. He was a learned man with a thorough knowledge of the scriptures. He had been instructed in the invited him to their home and explained to him the way of God more adequately. When Apollos wanted to go to Achaia, the brothers and sisters encouraged him and wrote to the disciples there to welcome him. When he arrived, he was a great help to those who, by grace, had believed. For he vigorously refuted his Jewish opponents in public debate, proving from the scriptures that Jesus was the Messiah. What an incredible young man here, preaching boldly about Jesus, although he was missing a very important part of the gospel. So he's preaching, and we see this single guy preaching. He was a very learned man, thorough knowledge of the scriptures, and yet he had a married couple overhear him. This married couple was probably on a date, right? Married should be doing. Yeah. They're on a date, and they see this young man, and he's preaching. He said, man, we got to invite him to dinner. So they go up to Apollos, and they invite him to their home, and it wasn't just a dinner. They wanted to preach the word of God and the kingdom of God to this young man.
Wow.
And it's incredible. When he was converted, Apollos goes on to be one of the most influential evangelists in the first century church. Here, he was a great help, right? But we see in verse 28, now that he has the whole gospel, he's vigorously refuting the Jews, proving from the Bible that Jesus, in fact, was the Messiah. How incredible is the singles ministry? It's super incredible.
Yeah. Come on.
See, what we don't know is that the singles, in our singles ministry, they're the Marine Corps of the movement. What do I mean by that? The singles ministry, right, unlike the campus, are not bogged down with the four-year thing, right, to in their university. So what is the Marine Corps? The Marine Corps is sending Marines to every part of the world. You look at almost every mission team that's gone out, who's a good chunk of the mission team? The singles. We look at who went to Chicago. Daniela,
yep.
Who's a single, amazing young woman. Heidi, another amazing young single. And, Miguel, who's now an evangelist in the kingdom of God.
Oh, yeah.
Wow. See, the singles ministry, you gotta change your thinking. The singles ministry is amazing.
Yep. Yes.
We can find these young, amazing, talented people who just don't have a direction and give them a purpose. They can be as influential as Apollos. Do we believe that? We look at Miguel, a young man who's from the inner city, right?
Yeah.
Who's grown up and done some incredible things in the world's perspective. But to God, that means nothing. He now finds a purpose for his life, and is not only doing something about it, he's now an evangelist.
Yeah.
Who's soon going to go and lead his own church somewhere. That's what the singles ministry developed for us, the kingdom of God. But do we believe that? We got to believe that. That the singles will stir trouble in the world.
Yeah.
The Marys, Aquila and Priscilla, was this amazing married couple who understood the importance of bringing people to their homes. See, the Wow House Church, we have vision for the Wow House Church.
Yep. Come on, bro.
Nat and I, in a nice little drive, we went through every single member of everyone who's in the Wild House Church, and we had vision for them. We did a great lesson from Ron, and he really challenged us to get vision for everyone in your house church.
Yeah.
So I even like have an idea of a nice little ministry I want to call. Kids, in my mind, I was like, is that all you're gonna do? Because I grew up being beaten with belts and brooms and
Brian Payne.
One time, you know the vacuum extension?
Yeah.
Extension cords. When he said, talk about it, bro. Cops on you. You know, don't say that to mom. But when I saw these things in marriages in the church, I was blown away. To see a husband apologize to their wife, like, blew my mind. Never saw that growing up. And so the marriage ministry needs to have a conviction. We need to bring these young, amazing people into our homes to teach them things like finances, teach them time management, show them what a good family unit looks like. Right? That's one form of the marriage ministry. That's what they did with Apollos. They said, hey, come in here. Let me teach you the Bible more adequately. But they also showed them the kingdom of God. So the marriage ministry is the backbone of the movement. There would be no movement without the marriage. Why? Mostly because they give the most money. And I want to commend the marriage that for the past 10 years since the movement has started, they've been the financial backing of everything we're doing. And so it's incredible that this year, right, we're not doing a timeser, like a 10 times for missions. Right, we're doing by marriage. And I know all the marriages were excited. Like, finally, one year where we're actually not calling to be giving, like, everything we have. I want to commend the singles, and I want to commend the marriages. What is my challenge to the marriages and the singles? Very simple. By the end of this year, make one person into a disciple and baptize them. Think about the challenge. If every campus, if every team, if every single, if every married had this conviction to make just one person by the end of the year a disciple, we will have doubled our house church.
Come on.
And it's no longer a house church. Why? We're now a sector. Because now we have more Bible talks. Now we have more shepherds. Now we have more campus interns. We double our house church, we can really start to do something in Southland.
Come on.
But are the marrieds up for it?
Yeah. Yeah.
Are the singles up for it?
Yeah.
I believe if we do this, we can see God do incredible things. But along the way, guess what? You're going to stir up trouble.
Yes.
Why? Because you're talking to these young single people who have one focus, and you're telling them that is not your focus.
Yes.
What you're doing is not right. People don't like to be told they're not doing something right. But you're going to say, hey, let me talk to you about the kingdom of God. Why do we upset the world? See, we're trying to turn the world upside down. But why do we upset them? Why do we stir up trouble? Are we doing that to be bad people? No, I hope not. We're not trying to upset people on purpose. We're not trying to stir up trouble on purpose. Because if we're all honest, we want everyone to like us. So it goes against our nature to stir up trouble. It goes against our nature to upset people. But the reason why we upset and stir up trouble is because who we preach, what we preach, and why we preach.
Come on, bro.
Well, who do we preach? We preach Jesus.
Man.
What do we preach? We preach his teachings, which are found in the Bible. And why do we preach? Because of five words. Jesus died on the cross.
Amen.
So of course when we preach Jesus, his teachings, and we understand why we're doing it, because we're going to work hard, yes, you're going to upset people. Because Jesus' teachings goes against the world.
Yeah.
Yes, you're going to stir up trouble. Why? Because Jesus' teachings goes against the world. But if we forget our why, people, we're not going to be here to see the world evangelized.
Yeah.
See, this battle that we fight is one of the most craziest battles. It's been happening since the beginning of time. And no, it's not U.S. versus China. No, it's not a world power versus another world power. It is God versus Satan.
That's it. Come on.
What I love about the scripture. in all of LA and then to all the world.
Amen.
See, we preach